excited to visit in the house in Little Ones.
Little Ones, they love what we're doing.
And well, think about what's coming. 2 weeks. Easter. It's coming soon, isn't it?
Right.
I just want to welcome y'all this morning. We're going to do something. I want you guys to stand. This is something y'all know how to do. We're going to wave at each other. We're going to do it like they do in the stadium. I'm going to start on this side.
Okay.
Myers going to do the middle.
Okay.
We're going to do the wave.
Oh. No, we do better than that. Myra, get on the boat.
Just a bit of wave. Wave at each other this morning. Tell each other how beautiful you are this morning. And smile. Let's just sing praise of him and praise this morning together.
Praise the
come now. We come. faith in you that more and more are starting to break the bondage of a year of being held hostage within our own homes and behind our own mask and within our own 6 foot. We thank you, Lord, that you have given a sigh, at least, of relief. We know there's still a battle to fight, but we thank you that your house now is being filled. People are coming to your house. And we know it's wonderful to worship online. We're very happy with everybody that worships online. But that doesn't replace coming in and being here, sitting together, praying together, worshiping together, hearing the word and discussing it, and just looking around and seeing the beauty in every face. Lord, today we bring to you those who cannot, who literally are too ill to come, and those who are still under the bondage of sickness. And we have several today in hospitals, in nursing facilities, in homes being cared for. We have those who care for them. We pray for them. We pray for you to continue to release people and release families and cause yourself to be upon their mind. Let this Easter season, we're very mindful, Lord. Sister Pepper said yesterday, it's been 2 years since we got to plan an Easter or Mother's Day or Father's Day. We never thought we'd live through that time, but we have. Help us to celebrate what we can in your name this season as we look forward to celebrating what you have done for us. We praise you, Lord. We ask all of heaven to praise you as all of earth today, Lord. We ask around the globe, people will be thinking of what you did on Calvary and what you did when you took the keys of death and hell and appeared back alive and well to give us hope of a resurrection. In Jesus' name we are thankful. Amen.
Amen.
Are you washed in the blood?
we had some new ones added. We need to remind you that we need wrapped candy for the Easter egg hunt for Easter Sunday morning. I think we need that by next week, next Sunday. So if we have it by next Sunday, I'll bring it. I see that there's already videos over on the table in the gym. I want to announce to you that between March 14th and the 27th, Rural King is having a promotion for the churches. If you spend money at Rural King, bring the receipts, Carol, or Pastor, and you'll see that those are taken care of. And if you know somebody that shops there a lot, they don't have to be said here this morning. If you have a friend that shops there a lot, get their receipts too. We use those as well. Coming up is Nipchin Work Weeks for the campgrounds. That'll be April 5th to the 9th, 26th to the 30th, and then the 24th to the 28th of May. So if you're interested in helping prepare the camp for the youth camps and for the adult camps, and appreciate that so much, we'll make sure if you want to go, make sure you get there. Also, in your bulletin this morning, there's an insert that describes the Easter Sunday, all the events of the day, the sunrise service and the morning service, and then the Passover dinner that evening. And so there's a lot going on that day, and I want you to be part of it. It's God's house, and we want all God's people to have all the enjoyment of sharing in those times. Then if you look at their bulletin, next Sunday morning, it's going to be a special morning for us. We have our pastoral recall vote. So we wanted all of our church members to be here for that. We're celebrating that together. April the 13th, the Kentucky Regional Ladies Fellowship meeting. And then the 17th is the Spring Money Bazaar. And then the Holiness Summit, the 16th to the 18th. So there's a lot going on. And it's a good thing, isn't it? As long as we're reaching out to people, spreading God's word and sharing his word, it's a good time. My ask this morning is for the ushers to come up and take the morning's offering. Appreciate our God so much. While they're doing that, let's just bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, what a blessing it is to be in your house this morning. Father, we want to thank you for all the wonderful blessings from your hand and how you've taken care of us and providing for us. And Lord, there's just nothing we can say because you are so wonderful. And we can never give back what you've given us. Father, we pray this morning that with willing hearts and hearts of joy, we give back that part that is a part of us, which in Jesus' name we pray. are sick and lost and needing the Lord. We had a request that came in after the bulletins were printed for Judy Adamson. Remember her in prayer. The family of Connie Marinero. And I didn't know this to this morning, but there was a family of two Wilma Alpamans. One of them was Jean's sister-in-law, and our Wilma Alpaman is requesting that we pray for her this morning. And continue to pray for Wanda Carter, so doing some better, and Danny Dixie Tipton. There's just a lot of names on that list, isn't there?
Right.
Representing a lot of different types of illnesses. We just need to pray for each other, lift each other up. God knows each and every need. And if you don't have a bulletin with you now, make sure you get one when you leave this morning, so that you can follow not only just the prayer request list and pray, but to follow along with the events that's going on here at the church. You know, the scripture tells us to study to be approved. That goes for His word greatly, but also for your schedule. No one hear you say you weren't told. It's out there. Is there any other prayer requests this morning?
Like, we have a lady in our town that we just found out has been diagnosed with stage 5 renal failure, and she is going to have dialysis. Her name is Sandra Black.
So Sandra Black, remember that. Very serious.
Of course, remember my sister. She's had a little rough weekend.
And those of you that are in the church sanctuary this morning, you can look around and you can see that there's a lot not here this morning that were here last week. So there's plenty to pray for. And just remember each other. Does anybody have a word of praise? Sometimes God has touched them or given them an answer to prayer this week.
I do. Jim King's dog on the one spot, and he started to do chemo treatment last week. He's got to take 6 of them. This is why I'm strong. Sticking last 2.
So we've been praying for Jim Hunt. She said he's doing much better and starting to do chemo treatment, and things are looking good, looking better. Praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
Kayla Boone reports that she's doing well with chemo, and the Underwoods are expecting to get their second shot pretty soon, and hopefully they'll back out.
Lots of good news.
Amen.
If you would stand with us, we'll sing a prayer chorus as the pastor comes and leads us.
But I look back there and each week that I've looked and seen children, for this I pray. I had begged for this. And I was thinking, if Jesus could be here, he would speak to each of us and he would touch the different ones that have the really bad things going on in their life. But, you know, he would go back there and pick up those babies and bless them.
Yeah.
He would take time to say, bless them. You know, it is a wonderful thing to have our Lord. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, as we come again to you, we come this time just asking that you would be present. We know that you are present. We know the Holy Spirit is present and that you, Almighty God, are everywhere. But it's different to say, come in. We're in your house and we're mindful that we're in your house. And we want you to speak to us. We want to have the Holy Spirit to move within us. We want to have a God experience. We want to have gone to your house. It's not the same as going anywhere else on the face of the earth as to go into the house of the Lord. Today, Lord, we know there are many needs. We know there are people that could speak for hours about their need. But we also know that you know every bit of that need. And we're asking that you would just pass through the audience and help people to know, I, Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, am here at the right hand of Almighty God, sending the Holy Spirit to you to witness, we are aware of you, of your faith, of your needs, and we are here to help you. We ask that you witness that to each one, and we ask it in your name, Jesus. Amen. morning we have to go after that. He hasn't said a word yet. Not that I don't think he's being excited. There's some things I just really want you to know about. The Passover meal on Easter evening will actually be, you will come in here and have a song, and then you'll move over into the fellowship hall, and you will experience 5,000 years of history.
Amen.
It takes about an hour, maybe an hour and 10 minutes or something, but we actually move from the Passover in Egypt all the way up to the Lord's Supper, and then to our time. And of course, we just hit the highlights of those, but you will actually experience as much as a Gentile woman can lead you into the celebration of that Passover and what it means from the fat lamb in Egypt to the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, and then to us today. So it's beautiful, beautiful service. The meal is not a meal like you're going to eat because you're hungry. The meal is a meal looking at what it was like to be in sin and slavery and then to be set free by the Lord. It's an experience. Have any of you ever done the Passover before? It's a beautiful experience, so I encourage you to come. Today, there is a story on my heart that is situated, I think it actually might have a three-part. I think there might be three different parts to it as far as looking at it. One is the real thing that happened, and we're in 2 Kings 6 and 7 is where you'll find the meat of the sermon. But we not only are going to look at what happened in 2 Kings 6 and 7, but then I think it's one of the most typical, absolutely typical examples of how Jesus loves. And to the extreme that he loves. And then I think a little bit of it makes us think, just a tiny bit, of what we've been through this year. They went through in mega. But we've been through enough that we've experienced, those of us of much age, and we've experienced our culture change. And we've experienced a lot of things this year. So it makes you think, where we are, let me set the scene before we go to 2 Kings, and we'll probably start in chapter 7. In order to identify here, first think for just a moment. We don't want to go there too long, but think for just a moment what it's been like this year for you. I mean, think about, I have friends, I have an older sister who tried to stay completely secluded for weeks and weeks. She didn't do it very well. She's too much of a roamer, but she tried to just stay put. And all the family trying to stay away from her, so she missed, all the birthdays. She missed the Christmas, and missed, she just kept missing everything. Mainly the trips were out for the doctor, all of life. And finally, one day they were very concerned because the COVID had gotten very close. And the family was very, very concerned about her. And she said to me, you know what? If it gets me, it gets me. I can't do this anymore. So they passed it up in this house. I think there was millions that probably got to that place. It was like, oh, I can't do this anymore. I just got to see a baby. I've got to go see my elders. I just got to get out and go sit down somewhere across the table and eat with somebody. I just want to be social again. I just want to be who I've always been, to feel more normal again. Well, what we've been through this year, even though I don't discount it at all, because literally, Roger and I, we have, being social beings for 40-some years in churches, we know a lot of people. So we literally buried friends every week, this last 6 months. So I don't discount the power of what we've been through. But when I take you where we are in the Bible, you're going to find out we've been in luxury compared to what went on here. We're in Samaria. Now, if you looked at Israel, which is just 50 miles wide and 200 miles long, how amazing, isn't it, that it's that little tiny piece of land and the whole world still focuses on it. Well, after it divided, Jerusalem was the capital down here, and Samaria was the capital for these 10 tribes. They divided into 10 and 2 tribes. And so we're at Samaria. Now, up above Israel is Syria. And Syria has pretty much always been an enemy to Israel. And Syria had decided to come down into Israel and to completely encircle. Now, our encirclement looked a lot different than ours. Our encirclement was, all things will be closed. Only so many people can be anywhere. You must wear a mask. You must stay so many feet apart. Thou shalt not. That's about the end of our besieging. But when Syria's army came down and besieged, what they would do is they would cut off a city. They would just bring enough soldiers to cut off the city. And you remember, I imagine it would still be a lot easier to do than what we want to think about, to cut off electric and water and telephones. Probably a lot easier to cut off today than what we think it could be. I'll just say that and stop. But anyhow, they would come in and they would cut off the water supply, because it was literally a water supply, a reservoir, or a trickle-down mountain, or a cistern. They would literally take it over, cut off the water supply. Now, most cities were well known of that, so they had built some supply that came in under the rock and came up into the city. But still, they would cut off the city. So pretty soon, there was nothing moving. You've all been there, right? Except all you had to suffer was there wasn't any bread on the shelves. There wasn't any milk. We got one time till we wanted some salt to be able to melt the ice. There wasn't any salt. It got to be wanted by an appliance, and they'd say it was backed up. So can you imagine in the old times when they literally drawed a line around your city and nothing went in and nothing went out? It wasn't too long until they were hungry. I mean, they were hungry. Now, I'm not going to tell you all of it. You read chapter 6 to see how hungry they were, but because they have babies present. But I'll tell you some of it. They were finally so hungry. They were so hungry. I mean, there's nothing moving. We've eaten, if we're in Samaria, we've eaten everything we can. I mean, there's no more beans in the back. There's no more sheep that we haven't eaten everything of. There's no more potatoes in the hole. There's no more of whatever it was you don't like that you haven't eaten yet. There's nothing in the city. And finally, somebody down the city says, I'm going to cut up my donkey and sell it in pieces. And a bunch of people together and say, let's go buy that donkey. Maybe we'll make soup. I don't know what we're going to do, but we're hungry enough. We'll eat a donkey's head. And we get down there, and it sells for 80 pieces of silver. And we can't afford that, so we say, what else is free? somebody said, well, we've eaten all the doves and we've eaten all the birds, but that man over there has got some bird manure. And he will sell you a fourth of a scoop for 5 pieces of silver. So in that case, what you would have used for fertilizer, you now are going to eat. I mean, we are hungry. We are hungry. We are starving. And we're starting to do a lot of things that we would never, ever, ever think about doing. And if you want to think about how bad it is for us, you remember that some people have leprosy. And if you have leprosy, you're unclean. You remember that? And if you're unclean, you're not even in the city. You have been relying. One way that I was explained when I was in Israel, one way that I was explained of what actually happened in Israel with the leprosy was that, like, they would take them out to an area that, like, maybe would be down and underneath a hill up here, and there would be a settlement down underneath away from the city. And they would be down in that settlement. And then they were allowed to come so close to the city walls, not all the way in the city, but they could come close, and then they could yell, you know, like, food! We need food! Food, please! And they could beg for food. And then some of us who were compassionate would perhaps go over some food over the wall. Or, if that was your brother, your husband, your wife, your sister, your child, you, of course, was making sure that some food got over there too. But in this case, there's no food in the city. We're eating doves of dung, those of us who are wealthy enough to buy it. I mean, we're in trouble. I'll tell you what it is while the girls are out. Finally, one mother said to the other mother, let's eat your child today and we'll eat mine tomorrow. Now, as horrible as that sounds, and it is, it's literally a horror. Probably the babies were starving too. It would be a most horrific way to spend. But this was how Samaria was going on. Now, can I quickly move from that? And I want to tell you that in this city was an old preacher boy. There's an old preacher man here. He's one of those old kind of old preacher men that doesn't pay much attention to anything or anybody except the Lord. You know, one that's got a Bible and uses it. His name's Elisha. He was schooled under that old preacher named Elijah. Elisha has seen a lot of miracles. Elisha knows how to talk to the Lord and get an answer. Now, on the other hand, to give you another picture, the king is Joab, or Jehoram. And if you don't know that name, he is Ahab and Jezebel's boy. He's been raised with wicked. He's been raised with, you get in my way, I'll tell you what I'll do, I'll kill you. You remember the little vineyard that Naboth had? And the old king wanted that one little piece of ground, even though he owned all that ground. He wanted Naboth's. And he went to bed. I can see this big, rich king laying in bed. And Jezebel said, why are you in bed? What's going on? This is good. What's going on? Why are you laying in this bed? Because I want that Naboth vineyard and he won't sell it to them. Jezebel said, well, that's no problem. She went out and got a few men to lie about Naboth. Told horrible stories. Almost burned him. Got him taken down and killed. And then she said, get out of bed and go get your vineyard. He's gone. Got rid of him. I mean, they are wicked. So the king is walking upon the wall when he hears the two women talk. says, you'd think he would say, hey, we need to call on the Lord, but he's wicked. He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'll take the head of Elisha this day. I'm going to go kill a preacher. It's God of Israel's fault that we're starving. Isn't it amazing how sometimes the wicked people think it's God's fault? I've been wicked and I've been blasphemous and I've not followed the Bible and I don't honor the Lord, but it's his fault anything that happened to me. Well, this old king was that nature. I was going to kill the preacher. Well, the preacher had been in contact with the Lord. And the Lord had told him, I'm breaking this up tomorrow. The Lord said, tomorrow, you'll be able to take a shekel and buy a whole measure of fine flour. Tomorrow, you'll be able to take a shekel and go buy barley. How on earth is that going to happen? One of the king's men said, if God rolled back the windows of heaven, that couldn't happen. Oh, really? So Elisha said, it's going to happen, but you won't see it because you'll die in the process. Your eyes will see it, but you will not be dead. Let's read our scripture. Thought I forgot, didn't I? 2 Kings 7. Now, with all of that going on, somebody is in worse shape than the city. Have you ever looked around at everybody and thought, I know you have. Unless if you have, you come tell me after church because I want you to pray for me. Have you ever looked around at everybody else and thought, they've got it a lot easier than me? I would ask you to raise your hand, though. I know. But haven't we? I mean, don't we ever so often look around and go, well, no wonder they're doing the ball, you know? I mean, we just kind of that way. But isn't it amazing that Jesus serves the one who is in absolutely the worst situation in, even if you got yourself into it. No matter how you got into it, he still will come and help you. Then Elisha said, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time, shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley for a shekel, in the gate of Samaria? Then a lord on whose hand the king leaned, the king's man, answered the man of God and said, behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be? And he said, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but thou shalt not eat thereof. And there were, here are our guests. This is whom we came to visit. We are outside the gate with these men. There were four leprous men at the entering of the gate. And they said one to another, why sit we here until we die? You ever felt like that? It was like, I'm just sitting here till I die. And they give the reasoning. If we say we will enter into the city, then the famine is in the city. You know, they're eating horses, I mean, donkey's hands and doves manure in there. We go in the city, there's nothing there to eat. We'll die there. And if we sit still here, we just keep sitting outside the gate here. We're so hungry now. Can you imagine what's been given them if the city is that desperate? We die also. Now therefore come, let us fall unto the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall but die. The lepers looked at each other and said, this isn't working. You know, probably every one of us comes to came up against something and finally said, this is enough of this. This isn't working. I can't keep doing this. That's why people are getting out now of the house of the Lord. And they're saying, I just can't keep doing this. I can't keep going a year, 2 years, ignoring that the Lord exists because I'm afraid I'm going to get sick. No, I can't just sit here at home and die spiritually. People have finally figured out, I can't do that to Jesus. I can't act like Jesus has no power to save me. I can't act like he doesn't exist. I can't just sit here until I die. I can't just sit here in this house by myself or just with two or three people and just sit here until I die. I just can't do that. These lepers said, hey, we're sitting here today. There's no food inside. And if we just sit here, well, the preacher said it's over, right? And they rose up in the twilight. So they made it to near dark to go into the king. Lo, the king of Israel had hired against us the Hittites and the kings of Egyptians to come against us. Every so often when a city would get in trouble, they would send a runner out to other nations. And they would promise to give them tribute, you know, to pay taxes to them. Or they would promise to help them fight their battle. But they would send a runner to another city to get people to come help. You know, like we've seen the Westerns when the cavalry is coming. You know, they would hire the cavalry to go. Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight. Now, I want you to picture being one of these lepers. Can you right now with me? You're a leper. You're sitting outside the gate. You're starving to death. You literally are so hungry. You have a disease that's eating you to death. And now you have no food or nutrition. You can't go in to your family because you're not allowed to go inside the gate. Your family has no food to throw over. They're starving too. And you finally decide the only place around here to find food is the enemy. We'll just go down to the enemy gate. Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight. I can see those lepers being getting up and saying, go on, Ralph or Abraham or whatever their names were. Let's go down. Let's go. Well, what if they kill us? Well, that's, we're going to die in here. We might as well die doing something to try to save ourselves. So they left, when they rose and fled in the twilight, they left their tents, their horses, their asses, even the camp as it was, and fled for their life. Another scripture tells you that the soldiers had left a strewn path of things they tried to leave with, and finally just had to lay it down because it was too much. You remember, if you ever watched Wagon Train or any of the Westerns, where you saw the wagon trains that they would start with all those pretties and niceties, and then as the train got into tougher and longer and worse situations, they would have to set off the dresser or set off this or that, and scavengers then would come along and get those things and take them back and sell them in Missouri and so forth. So what happened here is those soldiers tried to leave with them, but they couldn't. But the camp is totally like it was left. And when these lepers came to the uttermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat and drink. Man, I'd say it was food going everywhere. I'd say they were grabbing that and eating like, boy, every mother would have been on, wouldn't they? I'd say they were really going at that food. They were gulping that drink down. They made look around. And they started looking, and there's silver, there's gold, there's raiment. So one of them said, let's go hide some. So they all got loaded and went and hid it. And came again and entered into another tent and carried thence also and went and hid it. So all they're thinking is, let's get our belly full, let's get something to drink, and now let's go hide us some booty, some riches. Then said one to another, we do not well. This day is a day of good tidings, and we hold our peace. If we tarry till the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Now therefore come that we may go and tell the king's household. And as you continue reading the story, you find they did go and get the word to the king. Well, the king is evil, and the king doesn't listen to the preacher. King doesn't listen to the lepers very well. He said, oh, it's a trick, they're going to go hide, and then when we get down there, they'll all come out and try to kill us. But he sent people to find out. And of course, it was true. Now the next day, as daylight comes, now picture with me, the king has men at the gate. Modern scenario. A few years ago, Black Friday at Walmart. That's a really simple little scenario, but you'll get it. You remember if you went to one of those 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock sales, and it was so crowded, and people would, if you turned your head to look at something, somebody takes something off your cart and put it on there. Well, can you imagine that? And now all of a sudden, you've heard that all this food and everything you want is laying outside the gates. Can you imagine how that crowd went in now? And the king had that man, that blasphemed God, watching the gate. Because he's one of these main men. You know what happens to men who watch gates of starving people who have now found their every kind of food you want outside? He got trumped to death. But the lepers, they said, we're not sitting here any longer. We're going to die here. We're going to die in the city. We're going to go face the enemy. And the Lord delivered them. The Lord delivered Samaria. The old preacher never bobbled from off what he said. He stayed right on it. And sure enough, when all that food started flowing through the gates, you think you can sell an ass's head today for fudge? When you go get everything, the Syrian army, and start bringing in all that food, you think anybody wants to buy doves dung? Well, no. Somebody says, look, he just shouted for that bag of flour. Sold. More of it out there. Give you a shekel if you'll give you a bag of that barley. Sold. Let me know it out there. So Elisha's prophecy came true when the Syrian army was raided. Here's the other third point. I want you to think about what we've been through and how it has affected us. And I think it makes it easier for us to now think of how Samaria would have felt even though we didn't go near that crucial. But I want you to think on the third point that I have in my mind. And I think it's the most important point that you'll ever get. Have you ever been where you knew you were condemned? You did something wrong. You said something wrong. You knew you were wrong. And you felt horrible. And you felt, I think of that sometimes when young people get themselves in a situation. Every time I hear of a young person that's rebelling and gets himself into a horrible situation, I always think of this, of how it feels to be so condemned and to get yourself into a situation, or even if you didn't get into it. I know people who were paralyzed. They can get themselves into the situation that they are. I know people who have terrible diseases. They didn't get themselves into it, but there they are. But what is it when you've got a whole city that is in need, and when you've got a whole army outside, who but God Almighty and His Son Jesus would look at that city and say, I see 4 lepers out there that need help. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that powerful? That the Lord, would He met the needs of the city, but He started with the 4 outsides that were in the worst condition. They are sick. They are outcast because of their sickness. Well, we've seen that this year too, haven't you? Sick, don't pass me in a room. But here we are. We're out here. We're sick. We're starving. But He let those men get up and say, I'm not sitting here while I die. I'm going to go check it out. And God had already cleared the way. And God used that to help clear a city. When I think that the Lord Jesus Christ, I wasn't one of those sinners that went out and got into alcohol and drugs and a lot of other things. But I was a sinner. I was a sinner because I thought I could run my life without him. And I had all of my plans and he could just wait in line. And my parents didn't know anything because they were just those old-time Christians that went to one of those churches where you pray around the altar and praise the Lord. But what could they know? So I had to go out on my own. And then when I got there and realized how wrong I was, that very night that I had come to the end of my rope, I found out something that I never knew before. My parents in Garrison, Kentucky got hold of God in heaven, and I got help in Berea, Kentucky. And an old pastor came and talked to me that night. Now, who but God can arrange that? I'm the one who was out there in need, but the Lord sent me out. Isn't it amazing that he looks at a whole city full of needs and he still sees the lepers outside the gate? I love this story. I love this story. Don't you ever let the devil tell you that the Lord doesn't love you. You just get up and punch him right in the face, not with your fist, but with Jesus loves me, buddy. Jesus died for me, devil. Don't call you buddy, it's the wrong word. You need to know, Satan, that Jesus died for me. He shed his blood for me. He became the sacrificial lamb for me. And no matter what you do to me, the Lord Jesus Christ will still come to me and help me and save me.
Amen.
And set me up on a rock and let me start new. Don't ever tell me he doesn't love me, devil. You are a liar. And you are the father of a liar. Jesus loves me. Heaven loves me. This story to me is one of the most powerful stories. I can almost go through the seeing those guys and just hearing them as they, you know, they first thought the riches would be to hide the silver and the gold. You know, because, you know, you get outside the city, you know, first we'll eat, then we get our bellies full, and we'll drink. And then, well, we might as well hide some of the silver and gold and clothes for ourselves. But then they figured out, no, this is bigger than us. God wants us to go tell everybody. So they became messengers. Isn't that how we all are? First, we're in our situation. We get saved, and all we can think about is us. I want to be saved. I want to be baptized. I'm just thinking about me. I must eat and drink spiritually till my soul's gone. And then finally, I'm thinking, wait a minute, what about everybody else? I should tell everybody how good Jesus is to us. Let's say it. It took me a little longer to tell that story, but I thank you. I can tell you were with me. It's a little bit of a big story, but in another way, it boils down to the perfect example of how Jesus loves us. It's a perfect example that goes with your songs of the day. His blood. I still don't know how he does it, but black semen can be touched with red blood and make you quite stubborn.
Amen.
One of the best chemical arrangements in the world, and it's all done virtually. That's not the reason. He does it spiritually. He does it virtually.
Amen.
And your sin is gone. And you invite him in as your guest, and he likes love and gentleness and kindness, and my goodness, the temperature in your heart just goes. And you can rest in your own self. Anybody need to pray?
Softly and gently.
invited to come and hear the news.
See, oh, the Lord is waiting and watching.
Anyone else, you're
watching for you and for me. Come home.
Have a board meeting.